First of all,
this is the BS Report with Bill Simmons.
It might be cool, I don't know. And if it's not, I don't care.
The BS Report with Bill Simmons.
Bill Simmons works for ESPN. He's also named the Sports Guy, and he writes a comical sports column. You must be a popular dude.
The BS Report.
It's got a real dirty sound, like a rusty steak knife cutting through a well-aged steak.
Now.
Here's Bill Simmons.
Good afternoon, everybody! It's the BS Report. That was the best Mad Dog Russo impression I could do. But, it was a tumultuous week last week for me and so many other guys and girls who love the Mike the Mad Dog Show. They split up on Friday. Chris Russo going to Sirius. He starts next month. He's going to get his own channel. And I just had to have him on. I wanted to see where he stood, how things were going, if he was excited about Sirius, how bad he felt about Mike. So let's bring him in. Ladies and gentlemen, the Mad Dog, Chris Russo. Chris, how you doing?
Hello, Billy. How are you, pal?
Interesting month for you, to say the least.
Sure was. It wasn't easy leaving. Hard to leave. It was even harder than I thought. I didn't think it would be that difficult. Last Friday was a hard show, it was a Mike and a Mad Dog memorial, and it was a little rough to take after a while. I couldn't listen that long, but I was very happy that Mike gave me the 5 or 6 minutes to call in because FAN didn't want me to do a last show, which I can understand.
Right.
And I was, so I was happy for that. Got a lot of exposure. And then, I had to put it, the Tuesday press conference that I did at the Sirius was fun, too. I had never done one of those before. So I'm raring to go here. Hopefully this works out. We'll have to wait and see. I'm looking forward to it. It's a big challenge for me. I'm raring to go.
Well, on Friday, I happened to see the show because they simulcast it on Yes Network. I have DirecTV.
Right.
Surprisingly emotional, like much more emotional than I was prepared for. That when you called in, you broke down at one point. The part that really got me was, your dad calls in, and he called in from time to time to talk about the Yanks. And he got choked up, and he asked Mike if he could keep calling in every once in a while. And it was emotional. It really was. Like I was getting choked up watching it.
A lot of people brought up my father to me. My father had called me about 1:30 that day, right after I was on, 1:35, and said, can I call in? I said, absolutely. And he called in immediately, and I caught the tail end of it. I didn't hear the whole gist of the conversation, but he's emotional, too. I think he actually caught Mike by surprise by saying, Mike, can I call you once in a while? Mike said, sure, Tony, the Santa Fe line will be open. So I think that set a tone. I thought it seemed like the first hour set a tone of the program. Mike did a great job at 105. Again, he gave me the opportunity. My father chimes in. Then the fans just kind of picked up on it. The governors call in of Jersey and New York. I mean, the old program directors call in. I mean, Calhoun chimes in. It was just it was a dramatic show. I mean, bottom line, it was a very dramatic show. I was surprised how dramatic it was. That show meant a lot to a lot of people. And, when you're in it every day and you're close, involved in it every day, sometimes you forget what that show means. So from that standpoint, that was a good lesson.
I was going to ask you that because you guys are pumping out this show for 19 years. You're in there every day. It's kind of hard to look at it from a big picture standpoint. And when it finally ended, I think a lot of people, including myself, who had gotten to know you over the years through the show, it really was like watching two people go through a divorce, as weird as that sounds. And, this was an amicable divorce, but still, it was kind of the end of an era. And, to a larger degree, people felt like they were losing these two people that had been part of their lives. So now they were going in different directions.
I think you hit it right on the head, Bill. I mean, I think you hit it right on the head.
Were you humbled by it?
Oh, sure was. How could you not be? Yeah, I was a little out of it all weekend last weekend because, I hadn't had a home yet. I wasn't, wasn't that serious at the time being. I was sort of in limbo.
Right.
I made a lot of calls last Friday to, the Bob Mueslers of the world and, Minkos and people like that, people who I had worked with at FAN. But, I was definitely humbled. Absolutely. I thought those 6 minutes, I thought I characterized the show in those six, seven minutes. I mean, I was upset. I joked around about my missed golf swing and my member golf tournament. I got on mic about the Yankees a little bit. So, I thought that first hour really did set a tone. I really did. So, it was a pretty dramatic moment. I was very impressed. The media treated it as well, too. A lot of media. I was surprised by how much media exposure the whole thing got. So, I mean, overall, I mean, if I had to have a send-off, and don't forget, last Thursday night, I had a rush to Bar A, you know, lo and behold, the old great infamous Bar A, mm-hmm. in Belmar, New Jersey, to fax in my to resignation, because the station wanted it relatively quickly. I had no fax machine with where I was down in Jersey, so I ran up to Bar A, and I faxed in 3 pages of my signatures, and then 20 minutes later, FAN announced what was going on. So there you go. It happened pretty quick, beginning last Thursday, about 5 o'clock.
Yeah, I was going to say, it was so abrupt that I think that's part of what led to how upset everybody was afterwards. I think, you know, people had kind of been bracing for it, and you know, there have been numerous reports that whether you might leave or you guys weren't getting along. We've been reading about that all summer. Mike admitted it on the air that you guys weren't getting along that great. Right. But at the same time, it ended so abruptly. I think people, it was really like getting hit by a haymaker, especially I was in New York this week, and this is 5-6 days later. Everybody is still talking about it.
I know. It was a real big story. You know, Sports Illustrated wrote about it. Now I get you involved.
Yeah. I was involved. I mean, I grew up with you guys.
I knew you were involved. I mean, I knew that. You know, I can't tell you how many calls I got in the last, from, say, Friday to Tuesday. I think the best thing I've heard from most people, I mean, you know, the people I've run into it, I went to a wet water park today with my kids. I went, you know, running in the Lavalette boardwalk. I was up in New Canaan one day last week. Everybody's basically said, I'm going to miss you, but congratulations. I mean, that's basically, I'm not getting, oh, I can't believe you left. What a disaster. I'm not getting, you know what, I've heard enough of you, leave. Most people, 99% of the people that I have spoken to, and now listen, some of the blogs are bad, but most of the people I have spoken to have said, Chris, I love listening. And good luck with everywhere. And good luck on your next endeavor. And that's basically what most people have said. So I think, you know, I mean, I think people feel close to me after 19 years. I think they feel a bond to me as talk show fans after 19 years, and bond to Mike too. But I mean, since I'm leaving, I'm going to hear it. You know, they feel a bond to me over the last week. I felt a lot of that. So I mean, that's appreciative too. I mean, it's been a dramatic week, no question about it.
At the same time, financially, if you guys are hosting a show together as partners, you're making half as much money as you guys could make on your own if it was your own show, correct?
I mean, remember now one thing about the finances of it, and I've read it wrong in a lot of places, and I haven't obviously corrected it. The figures that you have heard with what I was making is incorrect, more. I mean,
right.
I'm just telling you that. It's not 1.1 million or 1.0, it's more.
Okay.
And number two, remember, I don't have Yes anymore. So, I mean, Yes was paying me a lot of money. That's out. So I actually, although Mr. Carmerson took great care of me, and I love this opportunity, the idea that I have fled for greater riches is not entirely accurate. Sure, I got a raise, but it's not like that big a deal. The bottom line is I left because I couldn't wait. I got an offer. I couldn't refuse. I mean, SiriusXM gave me a channel and told me how to run it the way I wanted to run it and, you know, gave me basically carte blanche. I mean, I don't know, at 48 years of age, Billy, after 19 years, I don't know how you turn that down, to be perfectly honest with you.
Well, and also, you're at the point of your career, and I think Mike is too. Maybe Mike has been at this point for a while, where you guys had this show. It was as great as it was ever going to be. You were going to have as much of an impact as you were ever going to have. And maybe you kind of want to delve out there and see, hey, can I do this on my own? Wait, how good can I be without the other guy?
I think we're going to find that out. To me, it really wasn't a case of I have to leave FAN, I have to leave Mike. I don't care what you get me, I have to go. I don't care what. I want more money and I'm going to leave Mike. It wasn't that. To me, mm-hmm. It's really a case of I got an offer, basically, you know, from a challenge. And I like challenges, but remember, I wrote 2 books.
Right.
I'd like to challenge you something different. I'm 48 years of age. This offer is not going to come by the board in 5 years from now. As Mel told me, a little while ago, the bottom line is that he's giving me a movie to produce, direct, and star in it. This movie's not coming by the board again.
Mm-hmm.
You put all that in the mix. I mean, remember, I'm not going to simulcast this show for a while either, so it's not like I'm going to pick up the money that I left lost from Yes. This is really, to me, was a no-brainer. I mean, I think you had to take it. If you're in my shoes, you had to take it. I also think, too, I talk about challenges to me. I think it's good for Mike. I think Mike gets a chance to do his own thing for a little while. I think he's chomping at the bit to see how he can put this show together. He will be the ultimate boss. He loves FAN. He's a little bit more wrapped up in the New York teams, Yankees per se, than I would be. I think this is a good spot for Mike. I think he'd be motivated too. I think in a lot of ways, Chance, you do us both a little good right now.
So let's talk about your show, and we'll talk about his show, because one of the things that fascinates me is, what are your shows going to be like? Like, do you see yourself having a sidekick, a bunch of sidekicks like what Stern has? You're obviously not going to do it alone, right?
Well, I don't see myself having a bunch of sidekicks. I mean, I'm basically going to try, I'm going to have an update person in there. I probably will try to find somebody to help me along with the Friday football picks.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, I'm going to try to do this show, at least for the immediate future, I'm going to try to do this show the way I feel I can do a talk show. Now, I have to figure out a way to combine, Arkansas, Seattle, L.A., and, Portland, Maine, all into one. I got to find those topics that everybody in America can get into on a day-to-day basis.
You're actually better equipped to do that, though, than Mike probably is, because, first of all, you didn't even root for a lot of the New York teams.
Exactly. I'm not a New York sports fan.
Right. So I think from a national standpoint, people see Mike as a New Yorker. He's a dyed-in-the-wool New Yorker.
I see. And he likes it. Mike likes the Giants. He likes the Knicks when they're good. And he loves the Yankees. He loves the Yankees. Me, I don't have a favorite team in New York. I mean, I'm actually thinking, it'll be interesting to see if I can blend all the different elements of America into a good national sports talk program. I mean, I think I can. I'm going to have to find my way here down the road as far as what I think I need to do on a day-in, day-out basis. Maybe that does include a sidekick. Maybe that does include a different voice occasionally. I'm not going into it, though, thinking that I need to do that. I might learn that I need to do that within 2-3 months, but right now I'm thinking that my job here is to find a niche Monday through Friday, 2-7, and let's see if I can do that.
And they gave you your own channel called Mad Dog Radio, and it's going to be on Sirius, and eventually they're merging, right? It's going to be Sirius and XM together.
Right. It's going to be on XM 144 for a while, Sirius 123. This is the first show that's on both. I think that I probably... I'm not sure when the realignment is going to be completed. I would say probably at the end of the fall. So I would think for the first 3 or 4 months, you'll get me on both channels. Again, I got to hire some hosts. I want to make this a channel where if you're a big sports fan, wherever you might live in the country and you have SiriusXM, you plug this channel in, 123. You're going to hear a good sports talk program every day. No games, Bill. So it's not like it's 7 o'clock. I'm going to throw it to the Indians and the Mariners.
Right.
No games, just, normal talk show hosts doing their thing. I got to try to find some. I got some guys in mind. The channel will be launched after I get myself organized, so I don't think the channel's going to be launched until the middle of the fall. But for the time being, my job right now is just to make sure I can do a good show with my show, and then we'll move forward. And I think, September 15th will start, and, I'll do some shows prior to that. But September 15th will start full-fledged, and hopefully I'll do a good job with it.
And
strange day, strange day today, because Mike's at Bar A today. And Mike and Bar A is a show that we used to love to do, Southside Johnny, Belmar, New Jersey, outside, beautiful weather. So today is kind of a weird day not to be there, because that was kind of our home in the summertime the last, say, 8, 9, 10 years. So that's kind of a weird day today.
So when you start the show on September 15th, they're just going to replay it a couple times on that same channel?
I'm not sure how the replay is. Remember, replaying a sports talk program, Bill, is a little different than replaying Howard, because, what I might do at 3:05 and what I might say at 3:05 totally changes at 9, 10 o'clock at night. So I don't think we'll do that as much as you would think. I'll give you two examples, things that we'll do that I would not have been able to do at FAM. I guarantee it, October 1st, Game 1, baseball playoffs, it's a Wednesday. I guarantee it. I'll be in Wrigley Field for that first game. And you say, why Wrigley Field? Well, first off, they're going to have home field in the National League. And secondly, Fox will put them on every night at 8:05. So I'll do that show the first 2 days, game 1 and 2, Cubs-Dodgers, say, mm-hmm. Wrigley Field. And then I would think you'd see me at the World Series games 1 and 2, American League Park, on the 22nd and 23rd of October. Those games are Wednesday and Thursday nights. And I would definitely think you'd see me down in that ballpark on Wednesday and Thursday night. So I'm going to try to get this show on the road as much as I possibly can.
Wait a second. I see what you're up to. You have like 4 kids at home. You're going to start traveling.
I'm not stupid. I got kids 9 and under. Let my wife take care of him. Absolutely. The better off on the road there is, the better. The more on the road I am, the better off I'm going
to
be.
Did you tell her, honey, I have to do it for the show. I have to.
Basically, right now I have carte blanche with my wife. She knows I got to do some work with this. She knows I have to travel a little bit with this. I got to try to hire people. I might have to go travel to D.C. a little bit, hear some of the XM guys. I might go out to L.A. a little bit to do some things out there. So they know that. My wife knows that, so she's prepared for it these first 4 or 5 months. Now, again, 3 years from now, she might have a problem with it, but right now she's okay with it.
So I got to ask, how much of the stuff with Mike was overblown, accurate, all that stuff? I mean, would you consider him a friend?
Mike and I have been, you know, when you're with somebody for 19 years, there's no way you cannot be as, you know, you have to be a friend with somebody when you're with them every day, 19 years. 5.5 hours a day. I told Mike last Wednesday that I was leaving, for sure. I won't speak to Mike for a little while. I'll give it a little time. As far as being overblown with our arguments, we had issues from about Easter in March, late March this year, to about the middle of May. Those were rough issues. A lot of it had to do with just what we wanted to talk about every day. I might want to be in a shack in the Suns. Mike might want to be into the, the Arnold Bay Hill Invitational. So We had some issues there for a couple of months there in the spring. Sure enough, our program director brought us together on May 11th or May 12th. He said, you two got to get along. We both agreed. We both, I thought, did pretty good shows from May 12th forward. We also did 4 shows in the summertime. At that all-star game and everything else when everybody thought I could leave. So from that standpoint, I think that me and Mike's relationship is always a little overblown. I think people were looking for a situation where they could find out, well, Russo's leaving because he can't stand Mike, or Mike and him no longer like each other, so out he goes. I don't know how many times they got to say it. And I understand people are cynical. I'd be the same way. Bottom line is I would never have left unless I had this opportunity. That's what I mean. You can bring up finances all you want. Wasn't like I got an incredible raise. I left because of the fact that I wanted this chance to put together a channel. Now, me and Mike had some issues, but that's not the reason why I left.
At the same time, would you admit that you guys had grown apart a little bit? Because
a little bit, yeah. I'd agree with that.
Well, I remember, you know, in the mid-90s, you guys would be talking, and he would be like, dog, when you called me last night, you called me during that Knicks game. And like, it was obvious you guys had a relationship outside the show. And now I think this decade, it wasn't as obvious that you did.
I wouldn't say this decade. I would say last couple of years.
Okay.
I wouldn't say the decade. Don't forget, Mike got remarried in 01 or 02. I was very close to his wife.
Mm-hmm.
My wife was close to Mike's wife. We both had all the kids who were about the same age. I would not say over the last 7 years. I would say maybe over the last couple. But I would not say decade. And I'm not lying to you, Billy. I mean that. I would not say decade. I'd say over the last couple of years. I mean, Listen, Mike and me, it's a weird thing. When you do a public show together and then one person leaves after a long period of time, that reason for that departure is going to be dissected. So I understand there's a standpoint of people want to analyze this and try to figure out what actually happened. And you're right to a degree. Mike and I were not as close. I'd be the first to admit it. But I think if you heard me last week, Bill, for 6 minutes, you know, when I was on there last Friday, if you heard me last Friday, you could tell that, you know, that emotion was real. I wasn't pretending.
Yeah, and I think in a way it's like two teammates on a great sports team. Like I always think of Bird and McHale, who weren't like the greatest of friends, but the respect was there and they always got along.
That's a good, you know, they both needed each other. You know, Bird needed McHale. McHale was we all know how good an offensive player he was, and McHale needed Bird as proof, and Bird missed that whole year. So, yeah, 100% right. I mean, a little Bird McHale with us, I couldn't agree with you more. You know, 19 years old, I don't know how long I compare ourselves to Abbott and Costello, but, you know, those teams, those radio teams, they don't always last for 50, 60 years. Sooner or later, something happens. You know, 19 years is a long time, so it was about time. I think for me, it was the right move at the right time. I think Mike would do well. Hopefully I'll do well. So I think we ended amicably. From my personal perspective, it couldn't have ended the last week any better than it did. If you would have asked me to orchestrate the last week, the way I got out, the way we did the last show Friday, the newspaper coverage, The way Sirius got in there real quick and took care of me, the offer that I got, Mike raring to go, it could not, really could not have ended Bill any better than it did.
You know, the funniest reference, not funniest, but Phil Mushnick compared you guys to the Honeymooners, which I thought was the most dated pop culture reference maybe in the history of newspapers. But it was interesting to see the way all these different writers, a lot of these guys who antagonized you over the years, all kind of coming to the same conclusion, like, all right, I got to admit that these guys mattered.
I thought Mushnick was very unfair to Mike on Saturday morning. When he did the post-mortem of our last show, and in his opinion, Mike was, you know, a little too, I hate to use the word, but a little too pompous about it and everything else.
Right.
And I thought Mushnick was completely unfair. I thought Mike did a heck of a job last Friday. I thought his mood was good. His tone was good. I thought he gave me a chance. He opened up with the jingle. I thought Mike did a very, very nice job last Friday. I did not think that Phil was fair on Saturday morning. I think most people who listened to that show thought Mike handled himself very well. That was Mike's show. I was on for the 5 or 6 minutes, but that was a Mike show. And I think Mike did a hell of a job there last Friday, and I thought Mushnick was unfair. So other than that, I think the media treated as well.
So what will you miss the most? I mean, I know you're excited about the new challenge, but what will you miss the most about the show?
I miss the byplay with the New York fan. I will miss the Yankee byplay. The postseason baseball byplay. I will miss the connection that I have with the New York baseball, with the New York sports fan, whether it's baseball, football, whatever the case might be. I will miss, to a certain degree, walking in the streets wherever I might be, whether it's New York City, ballparks, New Canaan, Connecticut. I will miss, I'll regain some of this with Sirius, but I'm not going to be walking the streets of Fayetteville, North Carolina every day. I will miss the byplay, the attachment that the fans felt towards me and the show. And Dog, how you doing? Dog, can you sign this? Dog, my kid listens all the time. Dog, great interview the other day. Dog, great interview this day. Chris, great job here. You and Mike were funny there. Mike, great job with the opening up the Christmas presents on the air. All those things that we did, I will miss that immediate byplay on a day-in, day-out basis. I could do a show one day with Mike over at 6:20, and I go somewhere at 7:30, and I'll have people at the garden say, hey, guys, great show today. Or I'll go to the Shea, and people say, boy, I love that guy today. Chris, great show. I will miss that immediate gratification when each show is concluded. I will miss that, I guarantee you.
But you're staying on the East Coast.
Yes, but, you know, this is a national format.
Right.
I know we'll have a lot of New York fans there. And maybe I'll get this, and maybe this attachment that I feel will continue. I'm hopeful it will, but I have to go into it with, you know, eyes wide open and have to assume the dynamic with the fan might change some based on the fact that it's a national broadcast now and it's not going to be as New York-centric. So as a result, I may miss a little bit of the New York City bond that I had with Mike. I may be wrong, but I have to assume going in that I might miss a little of that. So
you guys hit every national story that you needed to hit.
Oh,
so
we did.
It's not like you weren't doing that.
It's not like I would walk down the city of Detroit, streets of Detroit, and Tiger fans would say, "Hey, you guys do a great job. I listen all the time on the internet. I do this. I watch you on Yes." I don't have that. Now, whether I can regain some of that with this channel, I think I can. But as far as the New York immediacy is concerned, we'll have to wait and see. I'm hopeful that everybody follows me over. I don't want to be naive to think that they all will, but I'm hopeful that I'll have that connection with the New York sports fan. Only time will tell.
Last question. You guys were kind of thrown together a little bit because I think they didn't renew Pete Franklin's contract, so they
Correct.
Just had this hole on Drive Time. You guys were thrown into that show, and it became what it was. And we see so much in sports, like with the pregame shows and with different radio shows, like these guys get thrown together. And a lot of the times, it just doesn't work. And with you guys, it worked for whatever reason. You just had the chemistry. Do you think that these networks and these radio stations, all these people, like they just ignore the chemistry and they just think, like, I'll get two big names and that's it?
I do think they ignore it. But, you know, Mike and Mike works. So it's not impossible the team could work. But the team concept in talk radio is very tricky. It's good on the one hand because you get two guys filling up five and a half hours of air time a day, which is hard to do. And if they're good at it, they can do that easily. the negative is that, you know, fans can spot when the chemistry is off in a second. I mean, chemistry is an intangible, and the serious radio listener who likes sports can sense when it's off kilter. So that's why it's an interesting dynamic to be able to secure. Mike and I didn't have the great chemistry there in 89 when we first began. It took us, you know, a couple of years to build a scenario where we were very comfortable with each other. I would think that our love of sports helped. I always go back to the spring of 94, 5 years in. That was the years that we had the Knicks in the seventh game of the NBA final. We also had the Rangers winning the cup. I always thought that that was a very significant part of our career. We also had the Giants in year two, me picking the Bills to beat them 49-3. We had that scenario, which I think helped us an awful lot because Mike was a Parcells guy and the Giants, of course, beat the Bills.
Yeah.
So you have these certain events that contributed to our growth. But I think maybe that spring of 94 when we were on the road so much, we covered 25 games between the Knicks and the Rangers away from Madison Square Garden. I thought that was a very significant part of our development. We had our bumps along the road. We had our issues, as you just alluded to. We had some in the last year or two. But for the most part, you know, 19 years, although rocky at times, I thought we got along really well for the 19 years.
So do you think you could have had that chemistry with, like, maybe six other people, two other people, or just Mike?
You have to just give Mike the credit for that. There's very few people in America who know as much sports as Mike does. There's very few people in America who have the wit that Mike has. Mike's very funny. People don't realize that. I think that you have to give Mike his due there. And Mike is a very funny person. He's very crafty. He's smart. And he knows a ton about sports based on background with Brent, based on just what he knows. He's perceptive. And there's very few people who have that package together. So for me to sit there and say, well, I could put Boomer in that spot, or I could put Joe Benigno in that spot, or I could put, you know, Michael Kay in that spot, or I could put Mike Golic in that spot. That's not fair to Mike. Mike deserves a lot of credit, and he deserves, you know, 50% of it.
I agree with you.
A lot of credit for putting that together.
I think maybe you hit 80%, maybe 82, but not 100%. And also, I agree with you that Mike's funny, and also I love when he laughs at his own jokes. That pushes it over the top.
Yeah, I know. Well, listen, you've been a fan of ours for a long time. You did that 24-hour thing. I got a million people respond to that.
Yeah.
I mean, you've been a huge fan for a long time. So if anybody has a sense of the Mike and the Mad Dog Show, it's Bill Simmons.
Well, I was especially – I think I was dating somebody in Connecticut the summer of 94, and I remember, you know, specifically like the Rangers, the Knicks, the whole thing, and how big of a part you guys were with that whole thing. Yeah, and I really do agree with you that that was maybe – the tipping point for you guys a little bit. It was the biggest summer in New York history, that's for sure.
I was. I mean, you know, that spring and summer when the Rangers won their first cup in 54 years and the Knicks played as well as they did, the Rangers actually overshadowed the Knicks. I mean, I was in Vancouver and Indianapolis, Houston. I mean, I was all over the place, as was Mike. I thought that was very significant. We also had tremendous ratings that spring, too. We had an 8-5 share, which is as high as we've ever had, right about there. I mean, I think the other thing I would tell you is that, you know, after 19 years, we still had basically the same piece of the 25 to 54 pie as we did when we began in 89 and 90. So, in essence, we did not lose any piece of the pie that we had over that long period of time, which is really, when you think about it, that's pretty impressive.
You also, in the summer of 94, you had OJ. That was you'll never top that summer. That was the greatest radio summer ever.
You're right. You had OJ that year, didn't you? You had OJ in the summer. He was a summer of 94. You're right. Summer 94 for OJ.
Yeah, they had to remember they split screen the trial. They split screen the trial, and then in game four or game five of the Knicks finals with the car chase.
And then the jury came out with their decision a year later. You're right. Yeah.
Hey, since we're not going to hear you until September 15th, do you want 45 seconds to enjoy what's happening to the Yankees right now?
Oh, I love it. I mean, well, when I see last night, rubber game of 3-7-0 in the third, you know, it's a laugher. When Damon drops a fly ball in center field, you know, he's a terrible defensive center fielder. They're 67-60. I do not want to hear about injuries. You know, Giants lost Noah Lowry all year. He won 14 games last year. He hasn't pitched an inning.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a Giant fan morning, but nobody cares because they're 52-70. But that's as crippling to me as Wong is to the Yankees. They still got a Hall of Fame third baseman. They still got a Hall of Fame shortstop. They still have a very good right fielder, a pretty good second baseman. They got a guy making $30 million a year at first. They got Pettit. They got a Hall of Fame closer. The Yankees should not be 67-7. They've had a lousy year. God bless them. Bottom line, God bless them.
And they could have traded for Johan and did not.
Yeah, and I kind of had an opportunity to augment their pitching. Excellent point, Billy.
Yeah.
And they didn't do that in the offseason because they want to let Phil Hughes pitch and he hasn't won a game. So there you go.
All right, I'm going to let you go because you need to buy some suitcases for all the traveling you're going to do.
Phil, thank you, buddy. You've been a good man, and hopefully we did a good job for you here in these last 20 minutes or so.
Hey, and you know what else? I really appreciate everything you guys did with the show. It's a big part of my life, and I'm definitely going to miss it, but I look forward to whatever you come up with on Sirius.
Good job. Thank you, Billy. Appreciate it.
All right, thanks, Chris. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye. Bye-bye.
Whoa.
Thank you for downloading the BS Report with Bill Simmons.
Too much fun.
Check out more podcasts at the iTunes Music Store or at PodCenter at ESPNRadio.com.
Peace out.